welcome everybody to this online event of the Forward Fest. We are extremely happy that we can talk to Peter Pomerantsev. I will introduce him shortly after this. First, I would like to welcome everybody here in this online hall. It's always a bit weird to talk to an audience that you cannot see, but we will do our best to make this a very informative evening about disinformation. This event is organized by ELF NGO Federation, Vlieg Uos, and Mo Magazine, which is my magazine, is the media partner of this event. Mr. Pomerantsev, welcome. We are very happy that you can free your time because, as you told me, you are currently in Ukraine, in Kiev, where you are involved in a project to investigate war crimes. So we are all looking forward to the output of this this project. I was in Kiev myself 3 weeks ago, more or less. I didn't witness the war crimes. We were focusing mainly on the humanitarian aid operation, which is also very active inside Ukraine, organized by Ukrainians themselves, which is an interesting story as well. But today we're going to talk about disinformation, which is a reality that I can say is polluting many of our public debates since a few years already. And maybe it has come into a kind of acceleration, especially since the COVID pandemic, but already before that, we had many events that you describe in your book, This Is Not Propaganda. I will make a little bit of propaganda for your book here because it is a very interesting overview that broadens the scope because you look beyond Russia, because now we are so focused on Russia, but what we learn from your book is that this is a global phenomenon that a lot of different parties, a lot of different actors are using since a bit more than a decade. So I will use your book to guide us through this conversation today. And maybe I can start already with your first chapter in your book where you're talking about the Philippines and the journalist Maria Ressa. And I immediately noticed that what you write about this brave Filipino journalist who wrote about the crimes of Duterte, that I noticed some similarities with Ukraine, for example, because she noticed returning narratives online against journalists and against her website, Rappler. She noticed a pattern. She studied all these narratives that were commonly returning. She noticed peaks in these narratives appearing on social media before certain political events. So she could really show that these narratives were orchestrated. So I recently spoke to a Ukrainian fact checkers organization called Stop Fake. And they discovered the same thing when it comes to the Russian invasion of Ukraine. And also in 2014, this was already happening. Did you also notice Russian narratives returning? And what pattern did you see in them? And how were they organized?
Look, this has really become a feature of our lives,
yes.
Ever since the kind of advent of social media and the large social media platforms, and it happens in every country. what's interesting in Russia is that it's become a really focused tool of foreign policy. So in that sense, Russia is unique, but in terms of the technology, it is the same if you are selling Snickers bars or promoting genocide. It's the same technology, the same techniques. The social media companies are designed to enable campaigns, advertising campaigns, or disinformation campaigns, or atrocity campaigns. And there is no difference in the way a troll farm works to the way a PR company works. The only difference is the content. So this is just how our information environment is set up. It's set up in a way to target people. It's set up in a way to focus on people. It's set up in a way to distribute very, very quickly and amplify. And it's set up in a way that is completely non-transparent. So we don't know who's behind campaigns, how much they pay, why they target us. So there is absolutely no difference between a legitimate political campaign, between a campaign to sell Snickers bars, and a campaign to legitimize mass murder. It's the same technology.
Could you maybe describe for the people who did not yet read your book, what were those narratives that the Filipino journalist Maria Ressa was discovering in the information space regarding her website, and how did she discover those narratives?
Yeah, so she was being, after she opposed the government of President Duterte, who were involved in attacks on opposition and also in a wave of extrajudicial killings to do with their war on drugs. I mean, literally tens of thousands of bodies piling up in the slums of Manila of people killed by vigilante gangs or by the police in the name of fighting drugs, but really it was just a sort of a war on anyone who happened to stand in their way. So when she started to write about this, she and her journalists were accused of being traitors, CIA agents, agents of foreign powers, elites, whatever, the whole kind of vocabulary. But it was really tied, it was much more than abuse. It was really tied to a specific process. First, you abuse an independent news source, undermine faith in them, poison their advertising environment because you're making them a toxic brand. And then you open court cases against them. And, you know, it's sort of a process. It starts with ruining reputation, destroying business model, and then suing people for, it could be quite stupid tax cases or something, but constantly taking them to court. And that's become a very common tactic in many countries, which to destroy independent media.
Yeah. So could you describe, because in your book, you are focusing a lot on this troll factory in St. Petersburg. Could you describe their industrial operation methods? Because the way you describe them is really, an industrial way, a fabric of producing all kinds of fake stories and really polluting the entire information space. You even describe that one person goes into it as an undercover, and when she comes home among her friends and family, she hears the narratives, the fake narratives that she herself was asked to spread during her work in this troll factory. So it invades people's daily lives. So could you describe how this troll factory was operating, the industrial methods, and is it actually still operating today? And was it behind the narratives regarding this recent Russian invasion?
So basically, the recent Russian invasion didn't use information operations because Putin didn't tell anyone it was happening. So Russia's propaganda has been very slow to react domestically, internationally, and so on. So that was what was so interesting about this invasion. They didn't bother doing any propaganda beforehand, or very little. So now it's getting going slowly, but it's much harder for them to work because tech companies are much more aware of the sort of techniques they use. So it's been much harder for them to work since 14, and then much harder now. The narratives are coming back. They haven't disappeared, but it's much harder. So the height of their efficacy was sort of 14, 15, 16, when nobody really took them seriously. And then they could pump out, you know, stories or memes or narrative lines on all kinds of social media platforms. They created fake news sites. They created fake blogs pretending to be, you know, astrologists who would build up an audience and then feed people their some political stuff in between. Again, it's the sort of stuff that is used all the time domestically in the US. There's nothing interesting in the technology. There's nothing interesting in the techniques. The only interesting thing is that the investment from central authority into it and the use of it in foreign policy. This happens in every US election, every Mexican election. I don't know about every Dutch or Belgian election, but I wouldn't be surprised. So again, these are standard things that are used by everybody, but Russia has used them they're used by the centralized power, by official power, and they're used in foreign policy and in domestic policy. But I think really their age is kind of over now. I think that's something from the last period. I think we're probably in a new phase now. I mean, they're still active. I just don't think, I don't know how important they are anymore.
But they did have a big impact on events in the past.
Well, we can't measure impact. It's very hard to see. They were very prominent, but nobody's really developed an effective way of measuring impact about media generally, and certainly not about media as untransparent as this, where it's very hard to find a baseline. But there was a lot of it about. Look, as long as the environment of online media remains untransparent, as long as it remains a black box, as long as we don't understand what's going on it, there'll be opportunities for these sorts of campaigns. Certainly domestically in the US, they're still used very actively. I think it's got harder for foreign actors to do it. ISIS and Russia were the two big phenomena in those years, 14, 16, 17. I think it's become harder both for terrorist groups, probably become a bit harder for the far right, and a bit harder for hostile states. The companies at least are aware of this, and they tell us they're doing stuff. So they tell us, we know there's a Russian troll factory and we're doing something about it.
Yeah. Recently, this is also something that I spoke to with people from Stop Fake, because they actually work not for Facebook, but they do work with them in making known certain propaganda. So they have this tool of Facebook that they can use to mark something that they see on Facebook, and then they fact check it. And as during this recent Russian invasion, a lot of Russian state media on Facebook were marked with a warning for the readers. So this collaboration between recognized fact checkers and social media platforms, is this a good evolution according to you?
Sure, I mean, why not? Any type of transparency is good. It's a good evolution in that sense. It's a bad evolution because one always has the sense that tech companies are doing the minimum and using nice little NGOs to get rid of their guilt, and not really tackling the problem at source. For the real action we need from the tech companies is full transparency, algorithmic transparency, transparent models, so we always know who's behind content, transparent models, so we know how much money has been spent on campaigns, who's being targeted, how, which of your data is being used. We really need to see that whole architecture of influence, and then we can have a democratic society, so that there's always a sense that the tech companies will take something that's been raised as a problem by the media, and then we'll use an NGO to kind of, I guess, disinfo washing. You know, we have greenwashing in environments. This is disinfo washing. So there's always a suspicion about that as well.
Yeah. You also write that the journalism credo with which you were raised is that in the marketplace of ideas, better information is the antidote against lies. And also at Mo magazine, this is how we mostly look at this phenomenon, that in order to fight disinformation and fake news, we have to become better journalists and use real news as a way to fight fake news. But today, freedom of speech is being used to falsify the entire information space, and even to oppress free speech itself by intimidation and smearing campaigns. So would you still agree with this journalism credo that you should only use real news to fight fake news, or should we engage in a much firmer dealing with this phenomenon?
Yeah, I don't think those are the only two. I don't understand what real news means, and I don't know what fake news means. I certainly don't think we should start doing disinformation, if that's what you mean, or lies. But I think we live in an era where some of the kind of like metaphors that we grew up with in media have proven to be mythical and lazy. So, for example, the metaphor of a marketplace of ideas, the idea that, the best information will win out through some, you know, almost mystical theory of rational choice. We'll just create good content and it will mystically influence people. I mean, it's spectacularly anti-scientific. Economists don't think about the economy that way. You know, behavioral economists have long debunked that. Nobody in epistemology or cultural cognition thinks about knowledge this way. And we seem to be holding on to a myth from a kind of a badly read understanding of 18th century philosophy. And this is our credo, you know, we just put it out there and it will win. And it's obvious that it doesn't. It's completely obvious that that's not how the human mind works. That's not how people perceive things. And there's, I think, a huge arrogance in just saying, well, the little people must read us. We are right. While the other side, the people who think about the information environment as a place that where they should manipulate people, and it's their job to manipulate people. So whether that's advertising or PR or political campaigns, or the people we're meant to be competing with, they don't think like that at all. They think about audiences very hard, they think about psychology very hard, and they think about how to exploit it. So we have to ask ourselves questions. Why are the facts not getting through? How do you reach people who believe in conspiracy theories? How do we engage people who do not trust the media anymore? That's a challenge. You know, we can't just arrogantly say, oh, let the little people come to the good information. We will lose, and we are losing all the time. So I just think we have a responsibility to making sure that the facts actually get through, that the truth reaches people, that people engage with it, that we have a role to play in an idea of the public sphere, which is not an idea that we think about very much. Again, we have a lot of very, well, we have like one essay by Habermas and one chapter by J.S. Mills to sort of understand what we're meant to do in the public sphere. We have a lot of assumptions about what is pluralism, you know, what is polarization. So I think we're kind of in an inflection point where in media we need to really try to understand how we can make good on our ideals. And what does it really mean to have a healthy and democratic public sphere? And what does it mean to speak truth to power? And all these cliches that we have, and that we don't necessarily think about all the time.
Now, you make me think about what happened in Estonia in 2007, which you also describe in your book. So there is a kind of parallel here with what happened in Ukraine as well, because first there were stories created about a threat to Russian identity. This was slightly linked to some current real events. So that's mostly the challenge here when it comes to propaganda, is that it ties in to some real events, but they are blown up out of proportion. So the story was created about a threat to Russian identity and language in Estonia, where there is a Russian-speaking minority. But this appeared to be in a preparation for a large-scale cyber attack. In Ukraine, the same narratives of protecting the Russian language against fascists was also spread, and this appeared to be a preparation for an actual military invasion. So my question is, if information is being used as a preparation or even a tool of warfare, then don't we need a stronger response? Because this is not merely information, it is a weapon of war.
So this is a fantastic question, a question that I really want to start thinking about in my work in Ukraine at the moment. To what extent are the propagandists responsible for what we're seeing in Ukraine right now, mm-hmm. the war crimes and the atrocities? Mm-hmm. It's a question that we've always struggled to answer. You know, we have very few cases historically. We have the case from Rwanda, where radio propagandists literally said, take this gun, go to this church, kill these people. So the incitement to violence was really direct. Usually stuff like that doesn't happen. Julius Streicher, one of Hitler's propagandists, the publisher of Der Stürmer, which was the most anti-Semitic magazine, was found guilty at Nuremberg. But Nuremberg isn't necessarily the ideal model when it comes to legal process, that it is kind of symbolically, but lawyers actually question a lot of the decisions made there. You're quite right. So usually, no chance. Usually propagandists don't even get on the sanctions lists. I remember talking to American officials after 2014 asking, why aren't Russian propagandists who were openly part of the invasion of Crimea, why aren't they on the sanctions list? And the American officials were like, we don't touch information. Like, free speech is free speech. So it's really hard. You're right into this kind of like, you know, war crimes, war crimes versus free speech debate. And generally the free speech debate wins. The question is, as you're saying, when is the way to go when we see evidence of propagandists taking part in really specific operations? Also, when Russian propaganda does a lot of stuff about chemical weapons, that's, we saw it in Syria, that's usually a preparation of a chemical attack by the Russian state or by mm-hmm. its allies. So the Russian propaganda will go, you know, the opposition in Syria or the Ukrainians are about to use chemical weapons. And that's usually a sign that the Russians are about to use them and blame them on the other side. So it's a shaping operation to do an illegal military action or to cover it up. You know, Russian propaganda went very hard against the White Helmets, who mm-hmm. in Syria collected evidence of chemical weapons. At the same time, you also see Russian propagandists openly saying they're part of an information war, they're part of war. And you see them get medals, military medals for invasion. So after the invasion of Crimea, the head of Russia Today and others received military medals from Putin. So I guess I wonder whether those things push them into a space where we can start interrogating that. That's something I want to talk to lawyers a lot more about. We are in a world where information is so tied to military action, political warfare. Mm-hmm. But let's be honest that the historical legal tradition tends to let the propagandists off. So going back to Nuremberg, yes, Julius Streicher was found guilty, but Streicher was in the bunker with Hitler. Streicher was involved in planning. Can't remember if he was at the Wannsee conference planning the Holocaust, but he was the sort of person who could have been. The head of the Reichsradio, the German Nazi radio, whose name I've forgotten, but he was on trial as well. And he gave lots of anti-Semitic speeches saying Nazis are vermin, all this sort of stuff. He was found not guilty because he was not in control. He was not giving the order. He was just a functionary giving his speeches. So the historical record says no, but that doesn't mean we can't open the debate. And apart from the purely legal process, there's the court of public opinion and a kind of moral arbitrage. You know, do we feel that this is the sort of behavior that warrants, you know, these people being seen as journalists, because officially they're part of the media community. Until very recently, they would go to media conferences. Russia Today won prizes for the development of its cool news apps, you know? So maybe there's something we can do as an industry that starts to draw a line, which is again, very hard, between, you know, media and then operations, which are just really tied to military aggression and war crimes.
But maybe we can think about certain criteria. For example, in your book, you also describe that this organization of Yevgeny Prigozhin who is also involved in polluting the information space, but they do focus more on smearing campaigns against internal Russian opposition or Russian activists. So we can say there, like, okay, they do not make a preparation for war crimes, for human rights violations, for war. They are just engaging in smearing campaigns against opponents, which is also a violation of certain norms, but at least it's not a preparation for war and war crimes. But if, as a media organization, you participate in preparing the case for large-scale violations of human rights and war crimes, could we there draw a line and develop legal criteria against this these kind of violations and actually see them as part of a military operation?
I think these are incredible questions you're asking, Peter. And in a way, I don't feel qualified to answer them because I'm not a lawyer, but I do think we need to sit down both as a media community and the legal community and start thinking about this. I know of cases that were brought, especially around Syria, or people were thinking of bringing, because there the coordination between Prigozhin, the troll farms, between mercenary groups like Wagner, who he also funds and supports, between Russia Today and Russian war crimes was very, 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 very tight. So if we accept this idea of hybrid war, which is a stupid term, we've always had hybrid wars, but it really signifies the way that economic information and non-traditional military operations have been fused, then do we need a new set of legislation around that? It's a hard question. It's a really hard question. But Peter, I'm glad you're asking it, because I am asking, and I'm partly in Ukraine to think about it. But I don't have an answer now. I think we need to start bringing in the legal community to think about this as well.
It's not easy to find or to find hard evidence of links between so-called media and authorities. But for example, when I spoke to Olga Yurkova, who is working with Stop Fake, she told me that she noticed a kind of interesting dynamic around Russian attacks in Ukraine. For example, when the Russian army bombed this clinic in Mariupol, she noticed that it started with a lot of stories in the Russian information space about the presence of Ukrainian nationalists in this clinic. So a lot of Russian media were reproducing this story. It felt like a kind of orchestrated campaign, because a lot of media were reproducing the same message. And then she also noticed that after this information spread, there is always diplomatic action. So what the Russian Ministry of Defense actually did afterwards is informed the United Nations Security Council about the presence of the Ukrainian nationalists in this clinic before the attack. Then the attack happens. So it feels like first there is the pollution of the information space to create confusion, but then they also anchor this story in all the diplomatic channels, so they are kind of secure also on the diplomatic front. And then the attack happens. So could this show a kind of link between an information operation and a military operation? And if yes, are you noticing other examples in this current war in Ukraine? Similar examples?
Peter, that's a really good example. And I know Olga well, and I will reach out to her. That's exactly the sort of thing we need to start tracking. I think what we must do at this moment is start collecting this evidence, making sure that it's stored well, which again might need to be stored at a level different to what we're used to as journalists. You know, once we're getting into legal things, you know, every date stamp has to be treated in a much more rigorous way, every bit of evidence. So That's actually why I only got into Kiev yesterday. This is one of the big things I'm going to be exploring here for a big new project that I'm starting with my colleague Janine DiGiovanni, who's a war crimes reporter, working together with lawyers to think about all the different types of transgressions being committed here. And I think the story you just gave is phenomenal, and I'm going to follow up on that. Off the top of my head, I think we've all been looking at the chemical weapons thing. We're all trying to think a step ahead, because nonstop, this, like, the Russians are saying the Ukrainians, the Americans are going to use chemical weapons. And everyone who's been in Syria before knows that that's a sign that Russians might use them. So that's something we've been very focused on. But the hospital staying, brilliant. What a such a clear war crime. I don't think you need to be a lawyer to understand that bombing hospitals over and over is a war crime. But that it's being shaped in this really specific, granular way by propagandists is really important. The question then becomes, who's responsible for that? Is it the guy on TV? Is it the scriptwriter? Who's telling him? What's the chain of command? So there's so much to investigate there. What's the coordination? But I think that it's a brilliant example. And I do hope we can hold some of these guys to account, because, well, I mean, you know, I'm a great believer in freedom of speech, obviously, but when it gets exploited in this really, really cynical way, you know, that's sort of beyond being a provocateur. That's sort of really exploiting it in a really malign and specific way, you know. So you're right. We definitely need a conversation about this. I think that was a very good example. Thank you. You've inspired me.
Well, the honor is completely on Olga Yurkova's
side. I know her well. I know her well. I'll look her up.
Yeah, I interviewed her about this, and this is what she started with. And she sounded very worried when she described this to me, because she continued by saying that, we are noticing similar stories being created about the presence of chemical, biological weapons given by the United States to Ukraine. So whenever she sees a new story being spread all over in the Russian information space, she gets very scared, because she knows that this could be a preparation of something in real life. So these people who are studying propaganda narratives have become sometimes so scared because they can predict the future in a way. These are just some of my thoughts on this. These are information operations when it comes to certain targeted military operations, but then you have also the larger story that is being created, which you also describe in your book. Autocrats today tend to convince their people that we are surrounded by enemies. And you describe that this sense of being surrounded by enemies becomes the ideology itself. And you actually give the example of Alexander Vucic, who was re-elected as the president of Serbia. And I was actually in Belgrade at that time, a few weeks ago.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was very interesting to see the new propaganda message that he spread out, like peace and stability, Vucic. So those were three words that he wants the people to think of when they see his name. And as you describe perfectly, but maybe you should describe it, because I'm telling your book here. But I noticed it again when I was in Serbia, that this man presents himself as a pro-European when he is talking to people in Brussels. But when he is talking to the Serbian tabloids, he's a completely different man. He is using these conspiracy theories of being surrounded by enemies, and Serbia is still under threat, and we have to defend ourselves. Mm. So could you maybe describe this very common tactic by a lot of autocrats, actually, to convince their people that they are the victims in a way.
So, I mean, there's two things going on here. I think we're talking about victim narratives. I'm always reminded of Erich Fromm, the great German psychoanalyst who's trying to make sense of Nazi propaganda after the war. And he said something which I've always found very true in many countries that I've worked in, Serbia, Russia, maybe others, that when you see powerful people use victim narratives, it's really a way of them normalizing and signaling what they want to do to others. You know, it's like, you know, I'm the victim as a way of saying, well, I'm going to victimize you, and it's okay to do that. And he was focusing on Nazi propaganda, but we can look at Milosevic's propaganda. Vucic was Milosevic's information minister during Milosevic's dictatorship. So he's a man who remembers how well these narratives work. And, you know, they absolve people of responsibility. They allow the most sadistic impulses in us out. I mean, the Nazis would always say they were the victims, and that meant they could victimize others. So I think whenever we hear victim narratives being pushed by the powerful, not by minorities or the weak, but by the powerful, then we know we're in a really bad place. But this kind of multi-faced presentation is really, I think, something that Putin mastered in 2001 to 2008, his early years, Putin 1.0, when he still depended on the West, or thought he did, and when he still wanted to sort of plant Russian money in the West. He would do this very well. He would, you know, be a Democrat in the morning, a conservative in the afternoon, a fascist in the evening. And I think there's many who followed him. I think Orban learned to play that game. I think Vucic learned to play that game. Erdogan. And I think Putin 1.0 was really a model for many of them. How can you keep the veneer of democracy? How can you make sure you maintain your relationships, financial ones, with the West? But how can you destroy democracy from within? And Putin's system was all about that. So it's not just about showing different faces. It's also about, you know, having the veneer of democracy at home. You have a parliament. All the parties are captured. Or you have different media, but all the media are secretly captured. So I think, yeah, I think Orban, Vucic, Erdogan, I think in some ways Netanyahu tried to all look at him as a model, maybe Modi in India. So Putin 1.0 was a real model how to be the sort of postmodern autocrat. But we all know what that leads to. In Russia, that's led to Putin 2.0, who's just a, you know, flat out dictator, launch aggressive wars, and the worry is that all these other guys end up going in that direction as well. Is this just a stop on a path to being an all-out dictator, or is this a normal? So we'll see. I don't know. What do you think? Is this just the permanent state of Serbian politics, or is this just a step towards full dictatorship?
Cool. Yeah, that's an interesting question. Because, yeah, in Serbia, there is always a long history connected to these narratives, and there is a breeding ground for these narratives. Because when we talk about Serbia, we talk about a not so long ago past where Serbia was involved in large-scale war crimes, even genocide. But then they were attacked by NATO, and this gave them an ideal case to portray themselves as victims. So what I believe, if you ask my opinion, as long as this victim narratives are being spread out from the powerful onto the population, it will be impossible for Serbia to come to terms with its past. And the same happened in Germany. I mean, I believe, if you ask for my opinion here, and maybe it's interesting for the panel, for the people attending here, but I recently spoke to Mikhail Shishkin, a famous Russian writer, and he spoke about the empire mentality As long as countries exist that with leaders who have this empire mentality, who refer to the glorious past that they want to restore, which is also something you write about in your book, as the nostalgia that is driving leaders to inspire their people to restore a glorious past, to restore an empire of the past. As long as this exists, the chances of war remain. So what I think is that Serbia and Russia, and they should become normal countries where leaders are being elected to organize the public services of their citizens for the benefits of their citizens and drop their empire ambitions. Because these victim narratives are being used to pop up their empire ambitions. Do you have any thoughts on all the things that I just said?
So that's a very good point. So I think we have to wonder what do we mean by the empire mentality? That's such a good question. I'm actually literally writing a piece about this for the New York Times, which I'll probably have to finish after this conversation. What does it mean to have an empire mentality? Where does it come from? I think in the case of Russia, especially, if you look into it, if you look in the language that they're using, you move away from kind of an ideological interpretation, because it's such a mishmash of ideologies. There's Soviet nostalgia in there. There's different types of Soviet nostalgia, you know, very conflicting bits, a bit of Stalinism, a bit of Leninism, then hatred for Leninism, then adoration of the late Soviet period as a period of stability, but then hatred for that, for the stagnation and the economic corruption. Sort of Russian cultural arrogance, saying that Russians are greater than everybody around them. But then a kind of desire for Russia being the center of a multicultural movement. So all these very conflicting ideologies. And so I've ended up sort of looking away from the ideological part of imperialism and really much more to, I suppose, the psychological part. And there, it, you know, Russia, you could define as like an empire of complexes. You know, it's a set of unresolved traumas and aggressions. And I think sadomasochism that is expressed through politics and through aggressive actions that are like an empire. I mean, Russia is this unique country in a way that colonizes itself. It colonizes others, subjugates others, but then it treats its own people as the colonized, who are to be suppressed, put into gulags, use as slave labor, money to be extracted from them by governing elites. And at the same time, ethnic Russians behave like that towards others. There's no point in Russian history or Soviet history where there's any self-analysis, where there's any moments of mourning for the dead, where there's any making sense of the past. This never happens. The sort of Vergangenheitsbewältigung that we know from Germany, which is imperfect in Germany, just never happens. And you have just century after century after century of the cycle of abuse, humiliation, aggression. Very interesting, I was in a couple of weeks ago, I was in Ukraine, and I went to a village near the border with Russia, near Chernihiv, which had been held for several weeks by the Russian army. And it had sort of medium level atrocity, I'd say. Sort of, they'd packed 300 people into a cellar and used them as human shields. They'd murdered a few, but that hadn't been the kind of systemic mass rape and mass murder you'd seen in other places. But it was interesting how they split roles up. So the ethnic Russians were like, they were the good guys. They were in charge. I mean, the good guys. They put 300 people into a cellar and kept them there for their protection, apparently. Mm. People died in the cellar, but, you know. But those two was for their protection. And they behaved overall, they shared their rations, they behaved in a mature way, shall we say. And then there were people from an ethnic minority in Siberia, the Tuvans, and they went around drinking, going crazy. and sort of robbing people. And the Russians would go, well, you know, if you behave badly, Ukrainians, we'll set the Tuvans on you. The same thing is done with the Chechens. We'll set the Chechens on you. And of course, Chechens and Tuvans are completely brutalized societies who were, in their turn, subjugated, broken, their lifestyles mangled by the Soviet Union. And so, you know, you have the cycle of, you know, the Russians mutilating and crushing minorities, making them Russian or part of the Russian system, and then using them to brutalize others who are then going to brutalize someone else. Mm-hmm. And then the Russians themselves are brutalized through Russia's horrific and well-known history. And there's no moment where this is resolved. And you look into the language that of Russian expansionism, and it reminds me a lot of some of the weirdness of Nazi language. So Russians talk about this idea of a sphere of influence, which sounds rational at first, sounds like something from realist policy, you know, a security guarantee. We can negotiate around a security guarantee, that's fine. But when you dig into what they mean, what is their sphere of influence, you realize it's something very, very weird and moving, like a strange cloud. One moment it means the former Soviet Union, the next moment it means anyone who speaks Russian, the next moment it can mean, as it did for the recently deceased nationalist politician Zhirinovsky, everything from the Indian Ocean to the Atlantic. And there's very interesting analysis of the way the Germans used the idea of Lebensraum during the Nazi period. And a lot of psychoanalysts looked at this language. And they realized that the idea of Lebensraum wasn't really rational. It wasn't like, here is the German Lebensraum, you know, in Ukraine again, between Germany and the Urals that Germany deserved. It was sort of moving all the time, but the main thing, people were using it in a very emotional way. And they compared it to the very unhealthy states of German families, where infants were often brought up in a good deal of unhappiness and lack. And the Lebensraum was like an infant asking for more and more and more because it hadn't learned its borders, it hadn't got the attention it wanted. But also as a culture and a political culture, German political culture had created this generation of these eternally unsatisfied, aggressive citizens who felt both humiliated by their history and then desiring for something they couldn't have. Or look at the way that Putin talks about Ukraine, referring it at one point as a mother, the mother of Russian cities, or as a whore who sold herself to the West. And of course, making a rape joke about Ukraine days before the invasion. You know, while speaking with President Macron, Putin said he made a well-known Russian joke about how Ukraine would just have to lie back and suck it up, which is a Russian joke about rape. So basically treating Ukraine as a rape victim. So the mother, the rape victim, the whore. I mean, this isn't about geopolitics. This isn't even about empire as an ideology. This is a deeply, deeply sick political culture where warped family values and warped political values and political psychology feed an unending desire for conquest and a complete inability to analyze inwards.
When we talked about the victim narratives and the conspiracy theories that are being spread by powerful leaders that we are surrounded by enemies, we mostly speak about the very well-known autocrats that you summed up. But these victim narratives exist also in our Western European societies. Would you agree with this? And where would you find those victim narratives in our own societies?
Oh, look, we're all very, very, very vulnerable to these things, and they're not unique to any one country or culture. And obviously, like, you know, a lot of the Trumpian narratives were very scary because they reminded people of this. But at the end of the day, we live in kind of countries where, you know, I suppose, you know, we have checks and balances and it can be stopped. So we see them in lots of places. It's very worrying seeing them develop in Hungary, because Hungary is running out of checks and balances. There's no independent media, or there's very little independent media. Bureaucracies are captured, courts are captured. So I guess we have to be worried when these victim narratives, which anyone can exploit, start meeting systems where there's no way to stop them. And then we're in a very dangerous place.
Yeah, because I'm asking this question because, and you mentioned some, like Trump, you mentioned Hungary. But in your book, you also write about a far-right operation using the technology for disinformation around migration and Islam. It was called InfoKrieg. And it's very interesting how you start in your book the chapter Democracy in Confusion, how you start this chapter with the Serbian pro-democracy protest against Milosevic, with the resistance movement Otpor, and the guy who created a whole guidelines around how to overthrow a dictator. And you end this chapter by this far-right operation using his methods to spread disinformation around migration and Islam. So I wonder, what are you trying to say with this? By starting this chapter with a pro-democracy uprising and ending it with a far-right extremist group using the same methodology of in the information space. So what are you trying to say with this?
Sure, that's a really well, really thoughtfully read and very, very well researched question. So my book is really about, my book is really partly about how language and the language that was meant to articulate the way we see and understand and define democracy has grown old and died. And it's grown old because of time. It's grown old because the language that we used around freedom or democracy has become, you know, had its many disasters in foreign policy and was exploited. But also because clever people from the non-democratic side have learned how to misuse this language and exploit it and destroy it. I suppose this chapter was a little bit about that. It was about how people on the far right now embrace the tactics of pro-democracy movements, but also the language of pro-democracy movements. And that leaves that language completely empty. And it sort of, you know, it gets rid of its power in some way.
Mm-hmm.
So the identitarians are a very interesting group. They're based in Austria. And they're far right, but they don't look far right, quite the opposite. They look like quite young sort of philosophy students, lots of pretty girls. And they would never say, they would never use outwardly racist slogans.
Mm-hmm.
They would say they want to get rid of all the Muslims in Europe because they want to protect women's rights.
Yeah.
So they will take the language of liberalism and use it for non-liberal ends. So that's what I was trying to say. How, you know, the revolution against Milosevic is in 99, which is in a way the last wave of the revolutions of 89. How that language and those ideals have become kind of exploited and have become empty. And yeah, I suppose that's what that chapter was about.
Yeah. It's very interesting. So when you start talking about bots, the difference between bots and cyborgs, I will leave it to you to explain it. But their aim is to break connections between people online. So also what you wrote about this was so enlightening, I think, that whenever people try to unite around a certain cause, broadly named social justice issue, and they organize themselves online to create protests, demonstrations, activism. But then when it touches on certain interests, for example, in Belgium, there is a debate about racism. There is an anti-racism movement. And when the people unite around this cause, we also see some attacks on this movement online, probably by anonymous accounts, bots, cyborgs. And what you really describe very well is how these connections between people is broken up by these bots and cyborgs to create confusion, division, and to break the movement up by dividing their attention towards having to react to these attacks instead of talking amongst each other to create the change they want. So could you explain how they do this, how they break these connections between people inside a social movement? And maybe explain the difference between bots and cyborgs.
So look, these the differences are being whittled away all the time. I mean, look, I'm writing my book about 16, 17, 18, and technology changes very fast. And so, you know, we have to keep that in mind. So, but the aim of propaganda historically, and especially now, is to break connections and to replace it with their own sense of community. That's what propaganda does. Propaganda in the words of Jacques Ellul, perhaps the most important philosopher who looked at propaganda, is a cure for loneliness. But that means it also has to maintain that loneliness, because if you have genuine communities and genuine social movements, that's a real problem for malign propaganda that wants to sort of reduce people's agency and put you into the power of others. So, but it's very important for them to break social bonds. And that's, you know, that's why we see propaganda so successful at times when social bonds have been broken. Look at COVID and the way during COVID there's been an eruption in conspiracy theories and QAnon. You know, this all comes out of the loneliness of COVID. People feel lonely and they need some sort of pseudo community to exist in, which makes them very easily manipulable. So, but in terms of social movements, and I think social movements and pro-democracy movements, which are self-organizing, which use messaging, which use emotion, which use all these things that propagandists use as well, but use it in a way that strengthens your capacity as a democratic citizen, they're the real enemy of propaganda. You know, that's where the great conflict is. The conflict is between people-powered movements and propagandists, because they're very similar. They use very similar techniques, but the aim is completely different. So I think you know, it's we'll take someone like China. You know, in China, censorship is often imposed not necessarily on criticism of the state. Certainly before Xi Jinping, you could criticize the state. Censorship would be imposed the moment people tried to build any kind of protest or social movement. Even if it was pro-regime, if they were trying to organize a pro-regime protest, you know, censorship would start and the community would be broken up, because you're not allowed to have that agency outside of the state. And so I think in my book, I look at Mexico and the way various government troll farms would try to undermine protest movements by really sort of like creating social media accounts that would implant themselves inside social movements and then try to manipulate them from inside, split people up, would bombard them from the side with conflicting information, anything to confuse people and slow down their capacity to organize. So imagine you're doing this in real life, you know, you're in a group of people trying to organize a protest, and suddenly people are shouting at you from outside, and they're just shouting abuse at you. Your instinct is to turn around and argue with them. And that means they've already lessened your capacity to self-organize. Well, really, you should just ignore them and focus on your organization. So it's not, you know, that's the sort of thing. I mean, these are very tactical things, but I do think there's a larger kind of philosophical issue at play.
This connects to a question that I received here in the chat. And by the way, if anybody has a question, you can type it in the chat. And I will try in the last 10 minutes to address some questions. But a question that was asked now ties into what we talk about now. How to react to anonymous attacks by bots, cyborgs, or real people also allowing themselves to operate as a spreader of disinformation. But how can the sector of international solidarity and the social justice movement, which the organizer of the Forward Fest belongs to, because Aleph, 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 which is 11-11-11, is the historical international solidarity movement in Belgium. And of course, they push a lot of social justice issues connected to globalization in the world. So the question here is, how should we deal with those attacks and these attempts to break up the unity and the connections inside these movements? Should we re-attack on social media? That was a question. Or are we totally helpless?
I don't know what re-attack means. I'd be very careful about the language of militarization and whether that's what you need. You have to just, you know, firstly, like, the tech companies need to be doing a much better job of protecting social movements. So I think the first port of call is really pressurizing the technology companies, because they can do systemic shifts. But we really need a whole environment. You know, we need early warning systems that would help social movements understand they're under attack, especially when they're under attack from really quite systemic and aggressive actors, whether that's hostile states or various far-right movements, which are very well organized and very well funded. So we need an early warning system to protect us. We need an ability to appeal to, in this case, the government, which is the tech companies, to say, look, we're under attack, do something about it. That has to be a very rapid response. And of course, we need a counter-messaging capability. But again, that has to be quite strategic and thought through. And a lot of the time, NGOs just don't have that capacity or the knowledge. I mean, there's a whole craft to doing this. So all those things are needed. We are an environment where we will come under attack, where whether we like it or not, you know, whether it's Putin or Orban or the far right, they have decided that NGOs are part of a malign global elite, all sponsored by George Soros. You know, when they think we are an enemy, and we have to plan accordingly.
Yeah. You continue in your book about the concept of the information war. So I want to ask you a question about this, but first I will give an example of something I noticed in my daily life. So some children that I know told me that they are scared that on the 9th of May, there will be an atomic bomb on Europe. They saw it on TikTok. So I was really shocked about it. So what is in the heads of those kids, you know? But they see it passing on TikTok, where they are scrolling for hours. And then, to inform them correctly, the youth newsroom of the Flemish public TV channel, VRT, created information sheets online with the question, will Putin drop an atomic bomb on the 9th of May? The answer was, of course, no. But my question here is it wise to use the words of the propaganda itself to fight the propaganda? Because what I think is that when you put a question like that to children, will Putin drop an atomic bomb? even if you do it to inform them, you will still repeat the wording of the propaganda message, and by doing that, spreading it and strengthening it. How do you look at this?
Yeah, it's a really hard one. I mean, I think you're right. I think that can you can end up reinforcing messages. You end up strengthening them even as you debunk them. So yeah, there's a lot of evidence which suggests that. Then again, ignoring them is always an option either. So it's a real catch-22, and you always have to look at every situation and make that, you know, make that percentage estimate. Is it better to ignore it, or is it necessary to respond to it?
Because it reminded me of what you wrote about RT and Sputnik. RT is a Russian state channel. It is often called a weapon of the Russian information wars. But you actually write that by calling them a weapon of information war, you confirm them in their role. And the alternative is information peace. So when you talk about an information war, the alternative is information peace, where each of the sides respect the other's right to disinform. So this was very interesting thought that you wrote down. So is it wise to call RT a weapon of war?
Well, listen, this is how they call themselves. And as we discussed earlier, they could be legally very useful. But again, this is so on the one hand, we should, because that's, you know, we should point out that they are not journalists, that they are part of an aggressive war. On the one hand. On the other hand, there is this, every time we talk about the information environment in terms of warfare, we slightly risk confirming the worldview that they try to argue for. And the worldview they try to argue for is that there is no such thing as democratic debate, that all the BBCs of the world, or the Dutch public broadcasters of the world are all just political weapons, that everything is war, that all speech is war. And that in the end is a very kind of insidious worldview, and it's very cynical framing that you know, that basically reduces democratic debate to manipulation. So there is, again, it's one of these things. How do you balance that out? How do you both describe what they're doing, but also undermine this overall concept they have of information war? So maybe we just call them not information war. Maybe we just say that they're military. They're military assets.
They're military
assets. Say what they are. That's what they are. They're part of a military machine. Yeah. But this concept of information war is an ideological concept.
Yeah.
In Russia, it's a way of interpreting the past. So it's much more than just a technique. So basically, the argument goes from the whole school of academics in Russia that the Soviet Union lost the Cold War because of information warfare from the West. So not because of bad policies or bad ideas or anything like that, but because of information warfare from the West. And so therefore, the loss of the Cold War was illegitimate. All the arguments around bad politics or bad economics are just irrelevant. And all that Russia needs to do is fight back with its own information warfare. It's a way of undermining any ideas of progress or any idea of a public sphere, basically.
Yeah.
So one has to be careful not to sink into that whole worldview while saying what they are.
Mm-hmm. Being careful. My next question is connected to that, because again, it comes from a personal experience I had as a journalist. 5 years ago, I was in Odessa, where you also were. And I did some research there about Ukrainian ultra-nationalist movements in Odessa. I interviewed people from Azov, from Right Sector, from Svoboda. And actually, I did witness myself how they intimidated judges who were actually about to pass a judgment on one of their members who was involved in violence. So I did write about that, that their ideology is not democratic. And then I was attacked by Ukrainian activists saying that I was spreading Russian propaganda. And I was even reported to EU versus Disinfo, which is an administration of the European Commission that is fighting disinformation. So my article was reported there. So I did months of research and I actually carried out some real journalism, I think. But still I was accused of spreading Russian narratives. So my question here is, of course, Ukrainians have all the reasons to be skeptical and they know the dangers of Russian narratives. We have talked about it. But could it lead to paranoia in seeing these narratives anywhere, where in fact it is also just normal journalism? And what would you advise these Ukrainians? Because their sense of fear and skepticism is very understandable, especially now after this horrible war crimes being portrayed on them. But still, should they be careful in not going along in this information war, seeing war everywhere where it is maybe not, you know what I mean? So what would you advise these Ukrainians?
I don't know the details of the story, and I'm sorry that happened to you.
No, it's not bad.
That's very unpleasant. That is kind of it. Yeah, that is the moment where you just see everything as a campaign. And it's important. And you know, you're not saying Ukraine's been at war since 2014. Even in a time of war, to remain able to see, you know, tell the difference between a dirty campaign and genuine journalism. But I just don't know exactly what you wrote. I don't know exactly what they said.
I don't want to talk about my case, but my question here is just, what would you advise Ukrainians who tend to, for very understandable reasons, go along in this war mentality of seeing propaganda everywhere?
I'd say that even from a tactical point of view, if you want to beat Russia, which I think Ukrainians need to do, then you have to be very careful, just from a tactical point of view, to make sure that you don't alienate potential allies. Even if they do make a mistake, and I'm sure you didn't, but even if they do make a mistake, let's say they did misreport something, even then, I would think twice and go, okay, who is this person? Did they make him? Are they actually a bad actor? Fine, we go after them. Or did they just make a mistake or not understand something? And I would just think about the larger aim. And the larger aim is to win as many supporters as you can and to alienate Russia. So I would think very carefully about whether one's campaign is doing that. So just being a little bit more, you know, talk about that, you know, rather than abstract arguments, you know.
Yeah. In 2012, I was in Jordan and I met some of the Syrian so-called citizen journalists in a city in the south of Syria. And They went out to film during the bombings. And you also described this group of Syrians who, at a high risk of their own lives, still went out to film bombed buildings and how children were saved from under the rubble. So I talked to some of those normal Syrian guys, actually, who were before the war, they were working in a electronics store and, you know, normal people. And then I thought about this photographer in Mariupol, Yevgeny Maloletka, who was one of the last journalists in Mariupol, and he described it very well with his colleague with whom he was there. So the feeling I get there is humans always seem to find the motivation to collect the facts, regardless of expecting an impact. Because what you describe in your book is that neither for Syria nor for Ukraine, there is justice. And for Syria, it has been going on for 10 years and there is still no justice and not even a perspective of getting justice. But still there are humans finding the strength to collect the facts regardless of this lack of impact. So what should be the goal of collecting the facts in the face of massive disinformation? What should be the goal of collecting the facts? Is it justice, or should it be collecting facts regardless of any goal? It's a big question, but I want to hear your thoughts about this.
Such a good question.
And we have 5 minutes to answer it.
So why don't we just come back to why I'm in Ukraine, because you asked me why I'm here. So I'm starting a project together with the great war crimes reporter Janine DiGiovanni and lawyers from Syria, from the Syrian Observatory, and lawyers that worked in South Africa and Rwanda. And what we want to do is really bring together a response and a way of bringing a reckoning to all the things that Russia is doing and has been doing in Syria and Chechnya and its ally Milosevic did in Bosnia and its ideological partners in Saudi Arabia do in Yemen. They don't just want to do war crimes. They don't just destroy humanitarian norms. Their aim is to wipe out identity, meaning, the right to have your own meaning, and a sort of a right to exist. And to respond to that, you have to do much more than collect facts. You have to really understand very strategically what they're trying to do. And then think about what is the response to the information environment to that. So that could be a legal response. That could be a cultural response. That could be a political response. So as we collect evidence of what Russia is doing, we're not just collecting forensics of war crimes. You mentioned Mariupol. We are going to try to tell the story of the people who live and live there, of who died, its history. Mm-hmm. Interconnect what happened in Mariupol to what happened in Aleppo and Grozny.
Yes.
Sarajevo. So that there is both a legal response, and I think that legal response is very important, but it's slow, but also on a cultural level, we get to stop their destruction of reality and empower people to take back their right to exist. So that's our modest aim.
Yeah, that's a very big effort. I wish you a good luck with this, and I'm looking forward to the result. There is a question here, and with that question, we will close the evening. With Elon Musk buying Twitter as a way of safeguarding free speech on the platform,
right?
I feel like social media platforms need to do more against disinformation on their platforms. And will Elon Musk be the knight who will do this? That's my idea.
I have no idea if Elon Musk is a knight or just a very naughty boy, but. What do we mean by disinformation? I think this is the problem. We've used it very, very casually today, I think, as fake news, as fake, purposely distorted information. When we're talking about disinformation in the context of technology platforms, I don't think we're talking about it in that sense. I don't think there's anything you can really do about inaccurate information from a legal point of view. unless it causes really, really concrete harms, like maybe false information about drinking mercury helps you get over COVID. I mean, that's dangerous. So we can maybe do something about that. But usually when we're talking about disinformation in social media, we're talking about disinforming behavior. So going back to Maria Ressa, the first thing we talked about, the problem there was there was one person saying Maria Ressa is a Western spy and a stooge and all these things. The problem was there was a huge orchestrated campaign that looked like real people, but was actually 100 people sitting in a troll farm creating fake accounts. So it's that behavior which is disinforming. Not anonymity, but this fake amplification. Something that platforms say call coordinated and authentic behavior. So that sort of disinforming behavior definitely needs to be monitored much more. And the problem is at the moment is that the companies all say they want to stop it, but they mark their own homework and we don't really know what they're doing about it. So that would be the next step. Having more transparency about how they actually police their platforms, not just how they say they police their platforms. So will Elon Musk be the person who does that? I don't know. I don't know enough about him and his ideas of corporate governance. I don't know. He's clearly a very able businessman. His public persona is a sort of clown. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to think.
Okay. It's exactly 9 o'clock. So I want to thank you so much for your time. I wanted to ask you one more question, which I will not. I will leave it up to the people to find it in your book, because throughout your book, you are mixing the story of your parents who were persecuted by the KGB, and you're mixing it with the information war today. So your parents were persecuted because they looked for authentic knowledge, information, and literature that the KGB deemed threatening. And you mix it up with your experiences in the so-called information war today. So I wanted to ask you, what is your goal in mixing those two stories? But maybe we should leave it to the readers to discover it. And I will leave you in peace now. To your work, which we all look forward to, I think. And this is, by the way, the book. In Dutch, it is called Dit is geen propaganda. This is not propaganda. It's a great book. So thank you, Peter.
Peter, where are you, by the way? Are you in Antwerp?
No, in Leuven. Leuven is my city. You know Leuven?
No, but so is the Forward Fest based in Leuven or in Antwerp?
No, we are based in Brussels.
Okay.
I live in Leuven. And you're always welcome here. It's a beautiful city. Now I'm inviting you in front of all the participants to this debate. But you're always welcome to visit Leuven. And when you're here, please contact me. When you're in Brussels, also please contact us.
So I'd love to. Thank you for the very thoughtful questions. Really, really good questions. Thank you.
Yeah, it was great talking to you, and I hope the people attending also found it interesting. We will publish this conversation on our website so people can still read it. We will write it out and then people can still read it on our website, which is mo.be. So thank you very much, and I wish you a good evening and the rest of your stay in Ukraine to be successful.
Okay, thank you very much.